The reason I would like to that I wanted to talk with you is because if I have my facts correct, both Jessica and yourself actually decided to go to the Green Campus. When, in what context, and at what time did you actually decide to do that?
Okay, we'd been attending here for the last 6 years. It was right around early December that I got a call from Adam, the pastor down there, asking us to consider. We live down in the Akron area.
Okay.
And we'd been doing the 50-minute drive each way.
Right.
Every Sunday. It was well worth the drive, but the one thing that was always in the back of our mind was if only it was closer.
Right, of course.
So when we found out it was some form of it was going to be closer, that was good for us.
Yeah. Back up and let us know, how did you actually find Parkside in the first place, the 6 years previously? In what context did you actually begin coming here? Were you married at that time?
6 years ago, we started dating. It was actually, I had started coming about a year and a half earlier than that. She had grew up in the chapel at Akron. I found, actually, a good friend of mine had told me about some Scottish pastor on the radio. And
yeah, I heard him. He's no good.
Yeah. It happened to be at 12:30 on WCRF, right as I was leaving Akron U, driving home. And I think you were doing a series on Providence at that point, and I couldn't turn it off. And then when I found out that the church was here in Cleveland, that was even better. Grew up in a church, though, that didn't want us to leave outside the denomination, so it was pretty radical when I had, you know, let my family know that I wasn't going to be going there anymore.
All right.
So,
I remember now, and I remember meeting you. You would come in the evenings sometimes.
I started out in the evenings.
That's
correct.
Right. I remember you had a full head of hair then, didn't you?
Absolutely. Which I must say, if you come to Green, it doesn't mean you're going to lose your hair.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're kind of two for two at the moment. Yeah.
Yeah.
People are going, wait a minute. I don't know. How come everybody looks like Stuart Sink all of a sudden? You know. Who's Stuart Sink, people are saying, but that's okay.
Is it ever good weather out there?
Ever good weather out in Green?
No,
in Scotland?
In Scotland.
Oh, absolutely. Didn't you see it? There was a wonderful day there a few days ago. In terms of going down to Green, give us some kind of flavor of what that transition has meant to you. The good, the bad, the ugly. There may not be bad, there may not be ugly, but you know what I mean? I'm not looking for you to ferret things out, nor to sort of sugarcoat it. There's got to be some measure of feeling disenfranchised or, you know, whatever. How is it working out?
Our first reservations were the idea of knowing that a screen was going to come down and we'd watch the sermons on a screen.
Right.
We first thought, well, if we could do that on our computer screen or we could do that at home. So we didn't jump into it right away without thinking about it. But when we first saw the technology, we were more than pleasantly surprised. It literally feels like you're there, like the pulpit is life size. If you don't actually see, if you have no peripheral vision, you actually think you're at Parkside.
Mm. So. That's got to be weird.
Yeah.
Because I haven't seen it, obviously. How can I see it?
The flower arrangement looks like it's real.
Does it really?
It's good. Yeah.
Yeah. The flower arrangement is real.
Is it?
Well, not down there, but up here it is. Yeah. You think we're using plastic flowers? I mean, we might be off budget, but we're still using real flowers. Yeah. I mean, we go to plastic flowers, it's getting significant, you know. But right now, we're okay. Well, I had that as one of my questions, so I'm glad you addressed it, because it would seem to me that's a legitimate concern, and it's good to know that, at least from your perspective, indeed from the perspective of people generally, we've had the report back, that once the sort of initial shock of it is passed, you didn't even think about it anymore from that point on.
Correct.
You know, you have the you have the wonderful, you know, prerogative of just pressing a button and sending me back up into... you know, roll me back up into the wherever I came from.
It's very Star Trek.
Beam me up, Scotty. Okay. What are the things that you and Jessica are doing? What are the things that you, along with the others down there, would like to see done? What would the challenge be from yourself to any in our congregation who perhaps live in that direction or who feel a pull to that particular campus? Anything that you have in mind to say?
I think our biggest struggle was that anytime we would talk to neighbors or friends living in that area, and the conversation of faith would come up, and we would essentially say we drive up to Bainbridge to come to church. That was one, we would see the look on their face. They knew we were strange,
right?
But that we must really like church. We always got that a lot. You must really like church.
Sure, right.
But it's been a big help in the sense that I know that at least four or five of our neighbors, in terms of houses, four or five houses have come to check it out, where before 50 minutes was pretty daunting.
Sure.
I think that's the biggest thing. It's just the natural evangelism that we try to do in living our lives. Just with our friends during the week, people at work, just various things as we're engaging in conversation. It makes it much easier to say, why don't you come and check it out?
Right.
So.
And in terms of encouraging people from here maybe to get involved there, where are the areas of need and opportunity as you see them? We'll make this the last question.
That's fine. Everybody down there, especially Adam and Jonathan, have made it clear that they desire help. There's no stigma of, well, we weren't there before. It was they're wanting helpers. They want workers. So people who feel they have a gift in certain areas, they covet that. For those of us who don't feel we have gifts, they still like us to attend. So
sure. Well, thank you. Let's pray again. Father, just as we think of Adam and Jonathan, we pray for them, for your protection, for your continued hand upon them for good. We thank you for their faithfulness throughout all of the turmoil and the changes. We thank you for their friendship and fellowship and partnership with us on our pastoral team. And we thank you for the encouragement that they continue to be to folks like Stephen and to Jessica, so that they will enter wholeheartedly into the opportunities that are before them there on that campus. We freely acknowledge, Father, that we're just feeling our way ahead of us. We certainly don't have this all organized in a way that is watertight and foolproof, but we want you to know that we earnestly desire to serve one another as we serve Christ, to see unbelieving people become the committed followers of Jesus, and to see those who love Jesus edified and strengthened in their walk with him. And so as we think of all that means, both down there in Green and up here in Bainbridge, we ask that you will be good and kind to us and continue to pour out your blessing upon us in a way that we don't deserve, but which we sincerely long for and will greatly appreciate. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.